Okay.
So my name's Ania Camargo, and I am a volunteer with Mothers Out Front. And I am basically Mothers Out Front works. It's mothers and grandmothers that are working toward transitioning away from a fossil fuel infrastructure to a renewable infrastructure. And my focus has been on gas leaks, and I'm leading the campaign for gas leaks across the state. The reason why I've come out to Springfield and Northampton is that I desperately want you all to get involved in this campaign, because I think it really takes all of us to do this together in order for it to work and in order for us to be successful. I think all citizens need to be informed and care about leaks to make a difference.
So you're doing this with, we have a Mothers Out Front group here.
In Pioneer Valley, yes.
Yes.
So I am working with them, no question. They are fabulous. And so since I started the gas leaks in Boston, we're in the process of, all of these different teams across the state are taking on gas leaks, but they're doing it very much at the local level, having local action. So here in Northampton, for example, they're going to flag them all, and in the different towns in the Pioneer Valley, they're going to try to flag leaks, which is really great. But I'm here really to try and change the narrative so people know about the leaks and so that people know the natural gas is a big problem.
Great. Thanks so much, and thanks for coming out here.
Yeah, no problem.
Thank you guys all so much for coming. My name is Jesse Letterman. I am the environmental organizer at Arise for Social Justice. And Arise is a member organization of the over now 30 member Springfield Climate Justice Coalition. And the reason that we're all here tonight, as you all know, is to get more informed about the issue of the fact that there are over 500 ongoing gas leaks in the city of Springfield, some of which have been going on for more than a decade. And so as you know, till this point, we've been trying to build some more awareness around this issue, going out, talking with folks, understanding the economic impact, the health impact, the environmental impact, and trying to get to the bottom of how to get things fixed. We're also in preliminary talks now with Columbia Gas about meeting with them to understand what their timeline is, and we've done some letters to them as well and received some responses. So we're having, hopefully, the beginning of a productive working relationship. As my esteemed executive director, Michael M. Busey from Arise, that's here, always says, sometimes you gotta knock on the door before you bang it down. So I think we've done a very good job of doing that. We also know Michael M. is very capable of banging down the door when she's ready. I wanna thank a couple of people, especially for being here. Again, Michael M. Busey is our executive director at Arise.
Yeah.
I especially wanna thank our presenter, Ania Camargo, who is here from Mothers Out Front, and her associate Izzy as well. And we have our Ward 7 City Councilor Tim Allen is here as well to get informed on the issue. He may have stepped out briefly, but he is here. And so before we get started, this is the Springfield Climate Justice Coalition. We like to have fun as well as do presentations. And so Vern MacArthur from the Unitarian Universalist Society is gonna start us off with a song.
There's got to be a song called Banging Down the Door. I got to write a song called Banging Down the Door. How many of you have heard the song, The Tide is Rising? Anybody heard that? You know, the phrase, the tide is rising, refers to rising sea levels because of climate change. There's also part of the movement to fight that is called Rising Tide. And this song is to inspire movement, because in addition to knocking on doors and doing research and having meetings, we're going to have to build a movement. So your part goes like this. The tide is rising, and so are we. The tide is rising, and so are we. The tide is rising, and so are we. This is where we are called to be. This is where we are called to be. So let's do that. The tide is rising. And so are we. The tide is rising and so are we. This is where we're called to be. Okay. The tide is rising and so are we. The tide is rising and so are we. The tide is rising and so are we. This is where we are called to be. This is where we are called to be. Let's do it. A different verse. The task is mighty, but so are we.
task is mighty, and so are we. The task is mighty, and so are we. The task is mighty, and so are we. This is where we are called to be. This is where we are called to be. The sun is shining, and so are we. The sun is shining, and so are we. The sun is shining, and so are we. This is where we are called to be. This is where we are called to be. The world is holy, and so are we. The world is holy, and so are we. Holy, and so are we. This is where we are called to be. This is where we are called to be.
Now, I ask you all to rise and sing the first verse again.
The tide is rising, and so are we. The tide is rising, and so are we. The tide is rising, and so are we. This is where we are called to be. This is where we are called to be.
And one more time so they can hear it downtown at Columbia Gas.
The tide is rising, and so are we. The tide is rising, and so are we. The tide is rising, and so are we. This is where we are called to be. This is where we are called to be.
And so, how many 2 degreesers are here? Great. This is wonderful. It's a great group of folks. I want to thank all of our sponsors here tonight, besides 2 degrees as well, Climate Action Now, Mothers Out Front, the Unitarians, Climate Action Group. And we have the Abundance Farm, and it just went dead, so I may not be able to tell you who they were.
Peace and Justice, yes. First Churches.
Peace and Justice, First Churches. Right. Co-op Power, Divest Our Pensions Now, the Earth Ministry Team of First Congregational Church of Amherst, UCC, that is a name. Good group of folks, too. Edwards Church, Enviro Show, Green and Grace of Grace Episcopal Church in Amherst, Northampton Committee to Stop the War, and I want to divert for a moment because one of its members is going to be filming us here tonight, Paki, Wieland. She filmed in Springfield where we had a great gathering, 35, 40 people. It was a wonderful group of folks. Let's see. Oh, the Northampton Democratic City Committee. Peace and Justice Committee of First Churches. Pioneer Valley Mothers Out Front, but they deserve a second go around. The Social Justice Commission of the Episcopal Diocese of Western Mass, that's Margaret Bullock Jonas, yeah, and friends. let's see, and UUSA Green Sanctuary in Amherst, Western Mass Code Pink, and Western Mass AFSC. I have already seen much of this, not the whole thing, unfortunately. But when you don't know somebody and you ask her to come speak, you say, I hope she's really good. You know what? Ania Camargo, of Mothers Out Front in Boston and also of HEAT-MA in Boston, is really good. She is able to translate some incredibly boring stuff, boring and complicated and stuff, and make it as exciting and threatening as it really is. And so I'm very, very happy to introduce from Boston Ania Camargo and Sasa Camargo, her daughter, who was willing to run it for the first time to see what her mother does all day long. Thank you, Anya.
So you set the expectations too high. That's part of the trick. So thank you all so much for coming. I am passionate about gas leaks, and so I'm always thrilled when there's a room of people that want to learn about gas leaks, because I've spent about the last year and a half learning about this, and I'm with a volunteer with Mothers Out Front. I'm leading the gas leaks campaign for Mothers Out Front across the state, and so it is really great to be here. So the way we're going to do this is that this presentation is about 20 minutes long. You're welcome to ask questions if you want. I know there's going to be people in the room who maybe have never heard of gas leaks and don't know very much, and there's also going to maybe be a PhD in energy and something else. So I'm trying to make it so that it's a presentation for all levels of knowledge, so that's a little tough. If there's somebody in the audience who's an expert, feel free to pipe in and educate us all. But if not, it's really an overview. And my goal is to tell you a story, the story of natural gas, Mothers Out Front, and Boston's leaky pipes. And it's with Boston because that's where this whole thing started, for me at least. So here's Mothers Out Front, and for those of you who don't know Mothers Out Front, we are mothers and grandmothers and anybody who knows a mother. You're all included. And it's people who really have, you know, we really care for our kids and grandkids, and we want to leave them a planet that they're going to love as much as we've been able to love our planet. The goal of Mothers Out Front is to push for a swift transition from fossil fuels to renewable energy. And our vision is tens and eventually hundreds of thousands of mothers across the country evolving campaigns to address climate change at the local, state, and national levels. So we started very much at the local level. We started with gas leaks in my neighborhood in downtown Boston in Beacon Hill. We were a group of maybe six or seven moms who had read the Boston Globe article January 2015 that said there were all these leaks, and we were a little outraged, and that's where this journey started for me. But now I'm here, I'm like, I can now say I'm state, because across the state to visit you all, and that's really awesome. It's to sort of spread the word on leaks.
Did you really say 2015 in Beacon Hill? That's when it started?
Well, my portion, when we started this coalition, okay. It started for us, at least for our Mothers Out Front, getting important and reaching out and starting this campaign, started in January of 2015. So now we're gonna get into gas, natural gas. So here is an ad that I found on the internet. And here's the best part. Nature's Choice for Clean Energy. You can't make this up. the national fuel industry is sponsoring it, and I want you to witness how beautiful and green and gorgeous that is.
There aren't any trees, though.
But, well, you know, they're probably tucked over on that side. So here's a story that you've all heard, and here's a story that the public knows, and here's really, this is the national story on gas. It burns cleaner and produces less CO2 than coal and oil. This is true. Natural gas, when it is burned, it produces about half the carbon dioxide as coal. So this is touted loud and clear. It's also cheap and plentiful. The discovery of fracking in the early 2000s. It is actually very easy to obtain. It's all across the country, and it's plentiful. And so we are having a natural gas boom. And you know, trying to, and then the next part is that people have thought about it, and this is, you know, even President Obama thinks it's a bridge fuel from dirty coal to renewables. I mean, there's been this transition saying the way to close down coal, which is terrible, coal is terrible, is to really bring in natural gas, and then that'll give us time to invest in renewables. So this is the story. I'm sure you've all heard it. This is what everybody believes, and it's really new. So I would say it sounds really great, and what's the problem? Right? So this is what I want you to think about when you think about natural gas. These are fracking fields, and this is the reality, right?
Will we let her take a picture?
Wait, I know, but you can take a picture. So study after study finds that fracking and the natural gas infrastructure are hurting land, water, and people. And this is the reality of what's happening. And so that's the story I'm going to tell you today. So we have had gas for a long time in this country. In the early 2000s, when they discovered fracking, that conventional gas, the amount of conventional gas in this country was going down, but fracking was a boom, and so now it's actually, we get more fracked gas than conventional gas in this country. And it's obviously significantly more, you're doubling it. So now it's like, if it was at 50, it's now at like 70, right? This is billions of cubic feet per day.
Where was the conventional gas coming from?
From wells, just from, you know. Yeah, without having to, so the fracking is when the gas is caught in the shale, and so they have to put in pipes and water and chemicals deep down into the earth, and then and shake it up, and then the gas rises along with all the chemicals and the dirty water. I know you are all probably experts on climate change and the greenhouse effect, but I'm gonna go to basics. Here are the basics. So natural gas is 95% methane, okay? And methane is a very potent greenhouse gas. So the way here's our little Earth, and the sun comes in and heats the Earth, and then the rays bounce out and go back into space, right? So what happens is that carbon dioxide creates a blanket over the Earth, so it's harder for the heat to escape, right? So this is the greenhouse gas effect, and this is why there's global warming. The more CO2 we put, the thicker that blanket is over the Earth. Now imagine that methane, here we go. So here's our cute little Earth with our pretty little trees. Okay. And here is CO2. It's a blanket. It's a really nice blanket. So now let's talk about methane. Methane is 86 times more potent a greenhouse gas than CO2 in its first 20 years. So now imagine that one blanket. It's 86 blankets over the Earth in the first 20 years. And then over time, those blankets start falling off. So over 100 years, it's more like 30 blankets. A lot of times you'll see studies that'll say to you that methane is 25 times worse or 30 times worse. That's because they're thinking about 100-year time frame. If you think about it in a 20-year time frame, methane is 86 times more powerful at trapping the heat on the Earth. So scientists who are studying this are saying right now, methane is the most important thing we can be addressing because it buys us time. It's so much more powerful gas in terms of heating the Earth that what we need is to not spill any of this. And it buys us time to figure out, to get more renewables online and to do other things online. That makes sense. Okay. So now a little bit on how the infrastructure works. So gas comes from multiple sources. As we talked about, it's offshore, you can get it from wells. Onshore, you can get it from wells or from fracking. You can get it from offshore drilling, and you can get it from overseas as liquefied natural gas. So those are ways it comes into the United States. Then they get processed and treated in these plants. Then there are compressor stations. Compressor stations are every 40 to 60 miles of pipes across the country. We have compressor stations. Then they go to electric power plants, and that's where the electricity is created. They go to large industrial plants to produce products. Small commercial customers, your bakeries, and your any business around here getting some gas. Residential customers, many of you will probably heat your homes with gas. And then there's also gas-powered vehicles, and you've probably seen lots of ads that talk about how great, how green they are. So here's the problem. Every single step of the way, gas leaks. All of the infrastructure leaks. It leaks from the well, all the way, sometimes in your house, but all the way until it's delivered. It's all of the compressor stations leak, everything. And so for a long time, when natural gas was in its booming state, people like the EPA and most people said the leak is so small that it doesn't matter, it's still worth it. What's happened now in the last, let's say, 3 to 5 years, I think 2011 was the first time scientists from Columbia, Howard, started to study these fracking wells. And when people were saying it was like 1%, he started to discover that it was more like 8 or 9% of the gas was being leaked. And in fact, in some places, gas is being vented, so they actually let it escape. So So this is actually a huge problem. And the EPA right now is re-looking at the percents that they were using, because they're acknowledging that it was totally wrong, that we actually have a leaking problem, and it's not this tiny 1 or 2%. It's probably much bigger than that. I think for streets, they used to say it was about 0.5%, and now we're seeing that it's more like 3%. So what's the other problem? Well, methane is a toxic gas. Of course, it makes humans ill, but then the problem is also frack gas. It, because they're being pumped, it also contains all sorts of toxins, and here's the fabulous list from a doctor that talks on this: carcinogens, neurotoxins, breathing hazards, and hydrocarbons. So all of this is in methane. It is a lot cleaner on our streets, but if you live next to a power plant or a compressor station, all of this stuff is leaking out. So I don't know how many of you all have been following. This is the largest natural gas leak ever recorded. Happened this year in a wealthy Red. Suburb in LA. Did people see E.T.? The suburb, you know E.T., the filming of E.T.? Mm-hmm. That's Aliso Canyon. That is Port Orange. That's where this leak happened. This is the largest natural disaster, gas-related or energy-related disaster. The second largest after BP oil spill. You guys all know about this, that oil spill, but very few people actually know about this. It was not reported because people don't see the gas. They don't see it, and so it's hard to even film it and be sensational about it on TV. 1.6 million pounds of methane per day spilled between October and February. That is about 7 million cars, and that is about the emissions from 6 coal-fired power plants. That's how much was spilling every day. It increased California's emissions by 25%, and California is considered a state that actually really cares about its emissions, so it's the Governor Brown declared a state of emergency for this. 11,000 residents were relocated or evacuated. And planes were not allowed to fly over this because of fear that the planes would blow up. So this is just so massive and such a huge thing, and hardly anybody even paid attention. Of course, the people of California who live there are now very actively working against leaks.
How did it start?
So what happened is that people owned houses here had no idea, but underneath there was a giant natural gas storage facility. It was 1 mile underground, and in the 1970s, in the late 1970s, so imagine it's a giant storage, and then one, and there's a tube that goes all the way up to the earth, to our surface.
It's like a metal reservoir thing or something?
I'm not sure if it's metal, but it's a giant, enormous, it's like an old mine. And it's so huge. So what happened is that at the base of it, there was a valve that broke in the 1970s. And they didn't have to fix it, and they didn't. So when it started to leak and a little higher up, they couldn't shut it off. And so it took them 4 months to go in there to figure out a way to shut off the gas. But it had so much gas that it just kept spewing out. Incredible. Thank goodness, don't have that problem. But what we have is death by 1,000 cuts. So what we have is thousands of leaks. So we don't have this one leak. We have it across the state. We have about 20,000 leaks in the state of Massachusetts. And these spikes sort of show the different sizes. So it is spewing gas all over instead of one big one.
Just what does the PPM mean?
That's per million. So in 2013, Professor Nathan Phillips from BU, he had a study. He found 3,356 leaks in the Boston area, which is about 4 leaks per mile. What they did is that they drove a car with little sniffers on every street, finding out parts per million. So basically, you should only have about 2 parts per million because methane exists. I mean, it's natural also. But as soon as you start to see anything above 2 parts per million, it's a leak. When you start to see 19 or 28, it's a huge leak.
So that particular map is how much of Boston? Is it Boston?
So it's the greater Boston area.
Okay.
Yeah.
Um,
So here's what's happening. Why is this happening? We're an old city. These pipes are over 100 years old. These were laid in the 1880s. So they're cast iron, and of course they're starting to sort of corrode. And in addition to that, every 12 or 16 feet, there is a joint, and the joints are sealed with jute. Well, you can imagine what jute does in 100 years. It's not that great. So we have that problem. And what that has meant, that a more research study, so a year ago, some researchers were looking at the gas from the high up. So the first study looked at it from the bottom. The second study looked from high up and measured the amount of methane in the air. And they found that it was 2 to 3 times worse than previously estimated, and that if the leaks were stopped, it could heat 200,000 homes. So enough gas was leaking in Boston to heat 200,000 homes.
Wow.
This is on the heat website?
Some of this is on the heat website. So I will get into a little bit how we got this, but a lot of different organizations have teamed up together to provide this information.
Yeah. So by comparison, in the greater Boston area, how many homes are there? Repeat the question.
How many homes are there in the Boston area? That's a very good question. So the Boston area is like 3 million people. So just to give you, it's probably, I don't know, if you divide by half, mm-hmm. I don't know, probably a million and a half homes. Mm-hmm. So why is gas bad in addition to global warming? It's been exploded. This is very nearby. Springfield had I don't know if you all remember reading this in the paper. In Springfield, that strip club burst, and it totally leveled it, and I guess it really affected, two of the buildings next to it. It can harm human health. It can aggravate asthma and other respiratory diseases. And so what happens is that the methane goes into the ground, and it's a precursor to ground-level ozone. And so it can aggravate asthma and then all other respiratory diseases. And then the other thing that's really terrible is that it kills trees. It asphyxiates the trees and the roots, because the trees can no longer get the oxygen. And then the other thing about it is that you need the trees, because the trees take away carbon dioxide from the air. So it's sort of a double whammy. Killing the trees is a real bummer. And then here's the most amazing part, is that we all pay for it. So the leaked gas is passed on to the consumer via the rates. And that study from 2015 that said 200,000 homes says it's about $90 million a year just in the Boston area gets leaked and gets passed on to the consumer, the ratepayer. It's a piece of the rate. It's called lost and unaccounted for gas. And so we all pay for it. So what this means is that the incentive for the utility companies, if you can think about it, that they don't have any incentive to fix the leaks other than if they're going to explode. It's a disaster. It's really bad PR if it's going to explode. But if it's not going to explode, from their perspective, you're paying for the leaks and it costs them to fix it. So they're not going to, they have no incentive to. Yeah.
Does that mean that they actually know how much has been lost? If they're able to charge for it, what do they base the charge on? Do they have some kind of measure?
So that's a good question. They buy gas, and they know how much they bought, and then they deliver gas. So they're going to say, we delivered this much gas. It doesn't matter if it made it to the house or not, right? So it's what you purchased, and then it went out. So if it goes out and it goes into space, they still say, here's how much gas we have, and the rate for that gas is X, so they can just charge that. And the way they do the lost and unaccounted for gas, it's not only lost gas, it's also if there are accounting issues or timing issues, they can also, it's a plug number. But they can also, there are standards of what people have said in the past is being leaked, and so they can just apply. For example, the EPA says 0.5% of it leaks. They can just say 0.5% of it leaked, and then just multiply by their total, and then they just plug it in.
I just wonder if they really could calculate how much they've lost, rather than having to go around and...
Of course they can.
They measure it at your house.
Yeah, that means there's...
Is the $90 million per year actually used to repair infrastructure?
No.
Because it's being leaked.
But isn't the consumer being charged that amount?
Yes.
Yeah, but the gas company already paid
it's their
for
profit.
It, so they pretend like they sold it, but they just lost it.
Right. It's sort of like, we bought this much gas, that's how much we get out. So this is just
it's
being
not under the guy. It's right. It's not under the guise of we have to do repairs. It's under the
right.
We lost it, and you're going to pay for it.
Well, but they're not saying it quite like that.
Yeah.
They're saying it's not that much. It's not as much. We're doing everything we can, and yes, some of it's lost, and it's in lost accounts, and it's legal.
That's what I wanted to know. Legal. I mean, who's responsible for the fact that we're paying?
That's our Department of Public Utilities, our DPU, decides on the rate, and it is allowed to have some leakage. Now, one really important point is that the way leaks are graded in this state, there's a law that passed, I think, in 2014, that graded the leaks. There's three types of leaks, grade one, grade two, grade three. Grade one is the hazardous leaks, and they're the ones that are likely to explode. They're within a contained space. If you found a leak in your house, those have to be fixed within 1 hour. People have to come to your house, they have to come to your house within 1 hour, they have to fix it within 24 hours. Grade two leaks mean that they're within five feet from the foundation of a building. They have to sort of keep an eye on it, and they have to fix it within 1 year. Grade three leaks are not explosive, okay? So that means that even if there's tons of it gushing out, if it's not explosive, they do not have to fix it. In Massachusetts law, they don't have to fix it. The thing that's amazing about that is that most of our leaks are grade three, and the other thing that's most amazing about that is that leak in California, based on our rules and our definition, is a grade three. Mm-hmm. So if you're in Massachusetts, you wouldn't legally have to fix it.
So if we were gas users, and we wanted to sue, we would be suing the DPU. Because they are not regulating gas in our interest.
Well, yeah, so we are trying to put pressure. Yes, no question we want to put pressure on the DPU. So I think what has happened in the past, they're going to say, well, you know, there's always going to be some leakage, and it's part of what the program is. I think what's happened now is that it's so much bigger than ever. The other thing is that the DPU is, over the last couple of years, because of this happening, the utility companies are saying to the DPU, we are willing to replace these pipes, give us money to replace these pipes. And so every year they do get some money to replace. And they do some repairs. And the way they decide how much money to give you next year for repairs is based on how much they give you this year for repairs. So that actually doesn't help at all, because you can never have more repairs. And we're always having more leaks. Does that make sense?
But the gas company is really making a profit off that $90 million a year, so they're making a profit, right?
Well, they are making, no question. I mean, if you think about they have stockholders, and they are definitely trying to make money for their stockholders. Mm-hmm.
So is the DPU regulation going to change in like the recent court case where it said that the DPU had to enact regulations to put the Global Warming Solutions Act into effect?
That is the hope. And one really optimistic thing is that the DPU is catching on that this is a major problem. And they are currently, if there's a comment period in place right now until July 5th that people can write a letter, where they are looking into this in terms of getting the utility companies to start reporting on volume of leaks, how much, it is a huge, really great thing. We have some people that are working on writing these letters so that we have a sense of what we should be saying sort of legally. So I will definitely share it with you all, because I think the more people who can send in comment letters, the better. But yes, we are trying to work through the DPU. I really believe that the Department of Public Utilities wants to serve the people. The problem is that if you think about how people have thought about energy, they have thought about, okay, they don't want it to explode. They want it to be reliable. They want to make sure your heat doesn't go out. So they want to make sure, and they want it to be cheap. Those are the three criteria that these companies have operated under for years. Only, I would say, in the last, 8 years, have people started to think about climate change. and global warming. So it's not part of the way they think. And so all of that is changing, and I think the DPU is starting to figure out that that has to be a variable, especially now that the Global Warming Solution Act has been sort of upheld.
So who actually owns the pipeline infrastructure?
The utility company.
The utilities
themselves,
the gas.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So they own so technically they would be responsible. So why is it that the DPU has to give them money to repair the pipes when they own the pipes?
So because they are public regulated utilities. So even though they are stockholder owned, what they have to explain all of their expenses.
Yeah, okay.
Whether they do repairs or whether they replace a line, they are going to get reimbursed by the ratepayer. In other words, they are being told how much they can charge each person. They don't. It's not like any other business where you can say, you know, my rent costs $10 to make, and I'm going to charge $11 and make a dollar profit. They can't do that. They have to rationalize everything that can be included in a rate.
You mean give them the permission to charge customers?
Yeah.
You don't mean that it's
money.
We're not giving them.
That's
anything.
Correct. I'm sorry.
We're giving them permission to charge customers.
It is all about the rate. How much can they charge per therm? Right, and that's what but they have to rationalize based on their operating expenditures, their capital expenditures, and then how much they've paid for the gas. They paid more money for the gas, then your rate goes up. Right?
Incidentally, I'm not sure where you get such a positive view of how the department works. After 2.5 years of dealing with the DPU in multiple different kinds of cases concerning
especially
the Northeast Energy Direct Pipeline, let me say that you cannot be too skeptical or suspicious of the way this DPU operates.
So you know, it's funny that you say that, because I have that same impression. But I have actually been trying to meet with the utility companies, and I've met with the retired utility exec, and they hate the DPU, and it actually made me feel really good. Yes, they're like, they don't reimburse anything, and they're always on our case, and they don't let us include our rates, and we have, you know what I mean? So it made me feel like, oh, so those poor people are being slammed. So, I mean, that's why it made me feel a little better about it. But I'm not defending them. I'm just saying that the mentality to include climate change is a new thing. And so it needs us, the people, to put that pressure on the DPU.
If that's
on
new to them, then they're 35 years behind everyone in this room.
Yes, no question. Yeah, yeah. They're still behind. I mean, and you can just imagine, these are, you know, it is no question there's a lot of progress to be made. I guess I try to think that people aren't doing things to be mean. It's more because maybe the systems aren't in place or there's not the culture to push in the right direction.
I'm not suggesting meanness. Yeah. I'm suggesting total corporate capture of our regulatory system.
Yeah. Yes.
Not just in this state, everywhere.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask about that, because growing up, you know, playing Monopoly, like utilities seemed like something that was ours and served us.
They should.
And in this quick way that suddenly it was a for-profit thing, that the hybrid of that I still don't comprehend. And as you're talking about repairs, seems to me that maybe this wouldn't be a very profitable business if they had to repair everything.
That's
so
right.
So I think I'm getting
So here's the thing. So and the way I understand it is that to do a repair, you get a 3% return. So that you can include a 3% return. To do a replacement, you get like 10% return. So it's much more money. They get much more money out of replacing a pipe than repairing a pipe. And so they're trying to replace our infrastructure. That's a lot slower than repairing. They get very little money for repairing, and they don't have any cost with not repairing, because we're paying for it, right? Yeah.
Is it cost plus financing? In other words,
Yeah.
So whatever they can pad the costs, and then they add 10%, or they add...
Well, so again, meeting with the utility executive, it's so funny, because I was trying to get from their point of view, they're trying to make money wherever they can, but it's the DPU is supposedly very strict. go ahead.
In terms of measuring the missing amount of gas,
yeah.
So the gas company knows how much they put into the gas network,
yeah.
And everyone has meters, and they know how much gas they're actually selling.
Yeah.
So it's just subtraction
to find out
the difference.
So in fact, you know, we've tried to get them to do that. We've tried to say, well, what about if we looked at a compressor station even? Mm-hmm. Like through compressor, if you could monitor what's, but
what
they,
comes in and
they
what comes out.
Right?
No,
they
no, they are very, they, it's right. The only way that we get data is if the DPU or the state mandate that they have to give data, which is why this DPU letter is so important, just because the DPU is starting to think about, we want the volume of these leaks.
Yes.
This is for the first time. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It was very interesting. Our group wrote a letter to Columbia Gas and asking for them to account for all the gas leaks and to fix them. And one of the things that we got back was, first of all, they say minimal. No gas is leaking, or if there is any, it's 0.5%.
Yeah.
And then when they come out with numbers, they hint at numbers that are higher than 0.5% when you take that in minus out.
Yeah.
It's higher than 0.5%. The head of the company said it was from theft, from bad meter reading. Theft?
Yeah.
Bad meter reading and something else really ludicrous.
Well, so
you know, it's
why,
not that it's in the air.
That's what's so great about having all these studies that are looking at it in the air is you can't refute that the methane is in the air, right? So we know it's out there. Mm-hmm. Yeah, go ahead.
Is there any data about the difference between replacing pipes and repairing them, for instance? When pipes are repaired, do they stay repaired very long?
According to National Grid, it's a huge difference, and the reason why. What they say, and there's logic to this, is that since you have these joints every say 12 feet, if you repair a pipe over here, on this joint,
you're
going to go over to that joint, and that joint over there, and so one of their frustrations is that because the whole system is so old, that you fix it in one place and it pops up in another. And so that is part of the reason why they do that. But there are two great technologies that are out there to repair leaks. The other thing that they say is, we can't rip up every road. Can you imagine what would happen if you're ripping up every road to replace the pipes and it would shut the town down and people would be furious? And people would be furious. I mean, in fairness, if every street was being repaired at the same time, we would all be ready to kill them. So in my town, for example, you can only have two roads repaired at the same time. So that's it. You can't open any more holes and have because of the gridlock. So I think that's the first thing. But there are new technologies. One of them is called keyholing, where they can go through. It's like laparoscopic surgery.
Yeah.
So without having to tear up a road, they can do it with keyholing technology and go in little cameras and seal. And then the other thing that was in the Boston Globe, I don't know if you all saw it this weekend, I think, a CISBOT is these little robots that they can put in the pipes, and the little robots go in the pipes and fix the leaks, which is really awesome. Unfortunately, they're expensive and there are not that many of them, but I think there are new technologies that they're trying to put in, because the replacement program right now, the estimate is 17 years, for National Grid at least, for me, I don't know, Columbia Gas maybe more, but it's basically like at least 20 years kind of time frame. But we're saying is that's not okay. Like that's way too long. Like we have to get this fixed in the next 5 years. So anyway, but it's
so the game really is about short-term fixing leaks, not replacing.
So I think it has to be a combination of both. There are cities like Indianapolis. You know how many leaks Indianapolis has? 5.
Wow.
Yeah, they made a huge investment and replaced their pipes. Hartford has, for their population, they have half as many as we do, and they do the keyhole. So I mean, I think that there are places that we can look to really change the way things are. And I think the utility company, the more pressure we, the people, put, the more we do it in the paper, the more we make a stink, they are actually very susceptible to PR. They want good PR. They care about what we think. And so the utility companies are going to be much more responsive. The DPU is going to be much more responsive if we say that we care about this.
Are those public or private utilities?
That's a good question. I don't know. I have no idea.
Yeah. On that bill, is yeah. there...
This is not a here bill.
It's an Indiana bill.
Yeah. Indiana. You know why we did that? Because we don't want to blame one company versus another company. Doing like generics.
But is there a way, are our bills enough like that so that there's a way to figure out... $45 in the delivery charge.
So we have delivery charges in our league. Actually, you know, we do have, like, it is spelled out in our bills, too. If you look in your bill.
It's USG or something, unaccounted for gas.
Lost and unaccounted for, I don't know what the F is, but lost and unaccounted for gas. But that's in the rate. This is the delivery charge. Yeah.
That's listed in the bill, the lost and
unaccounted for. No, it's part of the rate, but I think it's more like the delivery charge, and I think it's a very high, it's increasing, that is more
so this $90 million isn't something that appears on people's bills directly.
Nope.
It's they get authorized to recover the money for the lost.
So the way the $90 million was calculated is that they looked at how much, when they looked up above Boston and they found out how much methane there was, they calculated how much total is being distributed and what percent is this methane of the total that's being distributed. And then they looked at the rate in the Boston area and they said, oh my gosh, if 2% of that total gas is leaking at the current rate, it's $90 million. That's how it was calculated.
I feel like that one's really hard for people to get their heads around. It's like you go out and you buy a gallon of milk, but it's missing a cup. Mm-hmm. But you thought you bought a gallon of milk, so you paid the price of a gallon of milk, but actually they give you a gallon minus a cup.
Yeah.
And it's the same thing. It's just we aren't actually getting what we're paying for.
Right.
And that's the difference from what we're getting and what we're paying.
Yeah. So all of that, those cups were spilled.
They were all spilled.
On the ground.
I just want to point out that it doesn't really matter if you actually use gas as heat or cooking, because half of your electricity is from gas. So that's another place where it's getting passed on.
Yeah, but here this is for these are the gas bills. Definitely this is this rate.
$90 million is just for the direct
heat. Yeah, it's just for the gas.
Is it also happening in the electricity rates?
Do they have lost and accounted for gas? I don't think they can do that because they are, I'm just thinking about how it's going to a power generator plant and then it's going through wires. So I think that they can, you know what I'm saying? It's like they're buying electricity. So utility companies are buying electricity that's made out of gas.
It's just up until the power plant, then after it's
passed on. I know, but not in the electric bill. I think that this is passed on only in the gas bill. They're leased at the power plant, but when the utilities are buying the electricity, they're not making it in the power plant. They are buying the electricity already. So maybe the price that they paid includes leaks.
And wouldn't the price be passed on with what the creator of the gas charges the electric plant?
I am 100% convinced that there are leaks everywhere in the system and that all of it is being paid by us. And so, I mean, I think the biggest thing that you all have to think about is how do we fix the leaks as fast as possible? Yeah. I mean, I think that's the bottom line. And I'll get into a little bit about that. But here's on the Boston greenhouse gases. I just want to give you a sense of our greenhouse gases. So this line is 100%. So greenhouse gases, there's an inventory, a greenhouse gas inventory for Boston and for the state. It's part of the Global Warming Solution Act. We're trying to reduce our greenhouse gas inventory. Right now, it's made up, this is how it's calculated right now. Steam is a little tiny bit, and that's co-generated steam. There's fuel, oil, gas and diesel, electricity, and natural gas. And this is what makes up our greenhouse gas inventory. The problem is that up until now, right now, the leaks are not included in our greenhouse gas inventory. So when you look at greenhouse gas inventory, leaks become the largest source of greenhouse gas emissions in Boston, in the whole Boston area, which is amazing.
Wow.
Because methane is so powerful and because the leaks are so prevalent. that's what ends up happening. So of course we are totally upset because we had made up, we had awards in Paris from our fabulous reduction. All of those reductions are gone if you take in the gas tax, count the gas tax. Yeah.
I have just something I'm going to throw out.
Yeah.
I went to the hearing that was held on May 31st in the Global Warming Committee at the State House.
Yeah.
And they said 7 major leaks.
Yeah, I'm getting to that.
Okay, all right.
I'm getting there.
Okay.
I promise you.
Okay.
So I'm going to talk a little about Northampton. Here's your map. And you have right now, so this is data from a utility company. So in 2014, the law that passed in 2014, central utility companies, you have to once a year report all your leaks and all your repairs. So we had 2014 data, 2015 data. 2015 data, the red are the repaired leaks, the yellow are the unrepaired leaks, you have 91 of them, and the blue are the mysterious missing leaks.
What is that?
The mysterious missing leaks went missing between December 31st, 2014 and January 1st, 2015. So either they were very busy. So we don't know exactly why they went missing.
They were yellow in 2014.
They were yellow in 2014, and they were never shown as repaired. They just didn't show up in the report. So this is something that all, so you all are meeting with Columbia Gas about this. We are meeting with Eversource and National Grid about this. So far, Eversource has said, oh, there's a good reason. You know, there's a million good reasons. A lot of, I always say that. They say, we probably fixed the, you know, a leak down the way, and so then, you know, it just went away. But you know, we have like leaks where there were no other leaks anywhere in the vicinity. So how do these go away? You know what I mean? Like, they're just, unless they self-repaired. I mean, like, there's no way. Yeah.
I think that this is explainable or understandable in part by what you may get into later on. The fact that in Boston, the gas companies reported only 1,700 leaks.
Yeah.
And yet when Nathan Phillips or whoever it was, whoever the BU team was, went out and independently just found leaks, didn't do their volumes or anything, they found twice as many leaks.
Right.
So they aren't looking as hard as maybe they should. That's maybe why they're disappearing.
Well, yes. We don't know exactly why, but we are right now in the process of trying to figure it out. And we have looked at, I say we, and it's very royal because it's heat. People you should really give credit to is heat and Audrey Schulman. And she has looked at 200 leaks, missing leaks. And she has found that the missing leaks are just as likely to be active as what unrepaired leaks. So basically they're still alive mostly, which is pretty extraordinary. And we have been in conversations with National Grid about it. They are very worried about it and they agree that there's a problem. And so we're trying to figure out a way to identify what's happening. Why, where are these missing leaks? What happened? What are the systems in place that allow them to be missing?
Just to clarify, you said they're worried. If they're worried, are they the ones not reporting? And they're worried about the not reporting?
So National Grid has about 3,000 missing leaks. And
So they reported them initially and then didn't?
No. So we said to them, we found 3,000 missing leaks. What's up? And so they said, oh, we'll look into that. So then they came back to us and said, well, 65% of them went off the books because they had a 0% methane reading when they were checked. You know, whatever percent of them, they actually gave us numbers, whatever percent of them were fixed but not reported, like people forgot to put down that they were fixed, like, but then when we went through the paperwork, they were fixed. So they went through and at the end of the day, they said there's about 300 out of your 3,000 that we don't know what happened to them, so we're looking into them. So what we said was, that's great, thanks, can you send us the data and we will look at the 65% and 0% and we'll double check it. And so they said, sure, we'll send you the data, and then they never did. So then what Audrey, who's so fantastic, I hope you all get to meet Audrey at some point, She went and they just started to look at the leaks and at just missing leaks, and they chose 200 random missing leaks and found that they're still active. So to National Grid's credit, when we went back to them, I said, look, that 65% number not looking good. They're like, oh no, that's, then there's a problem. And so we really need to do something about it. Yeah, so.
I wonder if what's happening is that there's a contractor who they've hired to find and fix leaks, and the contractor is, of course, that's partly a way to get out of their own responsibility, but that's where the missing leaks come from, because they
they're looking into that, because it is true that depending on the town, the number of missing leaks varies. So National Grid is interested in figuring out what's going on. I say it with caution that that we're trying to work with them. So far, we have gotten nothing. So we are in the process of having those conversations, which is much better than, say, our conversations with Eversource, which really sort of denied that there was a problem. National Grid is we talk to them probably like once a week with the person who's in charge of repairing pipeline, the pipes underground.
While we're looking at this map and this amazing website that Keith has created, got me to go to Belmont, where I grew up, and for 10 years my parents kept calling about a leak outside their house. And I smelled it, and it was there, and trees died, and it's not on the map.
Yeah.
So as I looked at the map, I was asking myself, like, okay, I know the utilities are reporting a smaller number than you're finding.
By a lot.
So, like, would it behoove that neighborhood to be like, we have a leak right here, make sure to put it on the map, let's tell Heath.
Yes, well, not a leak. No, not Heath. You need to call the utility company every time you smell a leak, no matter what. You can call them 10 times. Keep calling the utility, because that's what gets it in the books. We even if they don't fix it, because they don't have to fix it, we need to have them in the book. We need to have them report it. So every time you smell a leak, you call and say, there's a leak. I can smell the leak, there's a leak. And they'll
can
say where.
Can we get a sniffer and just use it?
So the sniffers are not super cheap. And there's Bob Ackley is the person that we work with from Gas Safety USA. You can hire him. It's not sort of, or you can be trained to do this if you were really interested in sort of becoming an expert. You definitely can be trained. But it's not one of those things that, like, I don't know how to do it, to go out and do it. I've gone with him in the car. We went on a gas sniffing safari around my neighborhood. It was really fun. Yeah.
So in terms of being able to identify the smell, like, if I'm walking out in the neighborhood and I smell something that smells like gas, could it be anything else?
So if you lived in a farm with a lot of cows, it could be the cow's digestive system. But really on the streets, it's very rare. That it smells like gas, it is most likely gas. Yeah.
Well, just to clarify, they add a chemical to
mercaptan,
and that's what we smell. Right?
Yeah,
you
so natural gas
smells
odorless.
Like cow poop.
Yeah, it smells a little like, I don't know, rat mix, but it is odorless. But they do add something to make it smell like gas. But so if you smell it, you should just call.
In my neighborhood, we have reported the gas smell at least 3 times in the 40 years that we've lived there.
Yeah.
Every time the gas company sends somebody out, and they drive around the circle and they check all of these places, and then they tell us it's swamp gas.
Really? You live next to a swamp?
No.
Okay.
That sounds suspicious to me.
Yeah, go ahead.
I wonder if you have encountered this. I was going around town talking to people with gas leaks, and this one man said, well, he smelled the leak repeatedly, and one day the gas company was coming to change his meter, and he explained to the...
Could you speak more loudly?
Yeah, sure.
This was a residence in Northampton, and it has a gas leak on the heat map, and so I went there and talked to the man, and he said, yes, he had smelled gas. The gas company came to change his meter, and he asked them about it. And the gas company person, who he trusted implicitly, told him that there was some kind of buildup of gas, I don't know where, in his house or something, I guess, because every now and then it would be released.
That's dangerous.
And,
that's dangerous.
Yeah, and I And anyway, for him, it was a great explanation, and it put his mind at ease. But I also, anyway, I just don't know if you've ever heard of that,
no,
that kind of a story
before,
what that might be. What are they talking
about? So, you know, I mean, there's also the other thing that does happen is that, and this, I mean, Bob will say, sometimes it does happen that you smell gas and there's wind. And so the gas leak is not right here, it's coming, like it could literally be from like a block down, and so the company could come and find nothing that you were smelling that came, and so, but it is there somewhere. If you are smelling it, it exists. It's just a question of where is it. So I think that we have one of our teams, our Jamaica plane team, has this thing called adopt a leak. And so all of the different residents have adopted a leak. Like, they're trying to go after the bigger leaks, but it's hard because we don't know yet which ones are the big leaks. But they adopt the leak, and they take care of the leak, they name the leak, and then they call the utility company constantly about the leak.
Okay.
And it's really, really cute.
Sounds great. Yeah.
So I live a block away from Orchard Street, which has many.
Seven.
And
yes.
Seven.
Oh, no. It's a two-block street.
I'm wondering... So would Orchard Street be a good candidate for replacement?
Yes, a fabulous
candidate.
Because
if there are that many of them.
So I would say that you should absolutely write a letter and try to meet with them and say, look, there are seven on Orchard Street. This is a perfect candidate for replacement.
It's a perfect candidate for a media blitz, too.
Yeah.
Yes, indeed.
You need to flag them.
Get some elected
officials
on
your
side.
So that's also been a very successful thing.
Yeah, go
ahead.
I think when I went to the website, I read some note about this, but in terms of like the precision or accuracy of where the markers are, can you give us any information about
that? So that the utility company tells you where those are. So they give the exact place, and then Audrey just puts them in Google Maps, right? And Google Earth.
Did they give the
GPS coordinates? Or
yeah, it is. Yeah. It's the GPS.
Well, it's the address?
It's not the address. It's a coordinate. Because I was like, what is this? When I first saw them, I didn't know what they were. And so she had to map, like there's a few that I got, and she had to map them for me. Because I couldn't even understand what the coordinates were. I mean, I could see the street name, and then like, maybe it's the blocks. It's like block 001, or, you know, I mean, like, so that's how she puts it into Google Earth. So the utility companies have to do, I think, a drive-by every 3 years, and they have to do a drive-by every year to monitor the leaks, and they have to do a walk-through every 3 years. So that could also explain a little bit about why there's some discrepancies. Yeah, sorry.
So are the only way that they understand like where the leaks are because of customers reporting them, or do they also identify
leaks? It's both. They are identifying leaks, and they have reported leaks. But the more you all call and report leaks, the more likely they are to appear on there. So you should definitely call them.
In terms of outdoor leaks, how much methane does there have? I mean, how big a leak does it have to be before the human nose can smell it?
I don't know. I think that's a good question. We were asking them, how much of it has to leak before you are willing to acknowledge that these missing leaks are real? Because they were saying, well, maybe if it's really small, like 3%, maybe it's not a leak, right? And so we're like, I know, but where's that percent? Again, they were going to get back to us, and we have not heard back. Like, what? Because I don't think that there's methane.
Well, I know, but there could be, like, maybe your dog can smell methane better than you can.
Well, this is another really interesting thing that happened is when we met with National Grid for the first time, he showed me that in New York, they actually capture volume of they capture percent methane of each leak. And so they can actually rate them. They can have like a graph that shows like the ones that are 0 to 20%, 20 to 40%, 40 to 60, and then like 80 to 100. And it's definitely a, you know, there's a lot that have very little. There is very few that have a lot. But they do that in New York. But they just don't do it in National Grid in Massachusetts. I mean, in some of these companies in Massachusetts. So,
So this is from the gas company.
Yeah.
So it might underrepresent.
Totally underrepresent. So the stuff that, all of the studies that I've done by BU and Harvard, say that there are many, many more leaks than are being presented in these data. But at least we have something to go by. You know, I mean, we're going with their data. They can't refute this, right? They can refute everything else we're doing, but these are the ones that they are acknowledging that they have.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, go ahead.
How are they, do you have a sense how they're deciding which leaks to repair? They've got all of these leaks, some of them are being, what, there's the criteria, they don't have to fix the level three, like, they have to fix the level one, they have to get around the level two.
Yeah.
Are they fixing the level three, and if so, how do they decide?
No, they're very little fixing of the level three. They definitely need to fix the level twos, and they plan those. That is a good question. I think probably every company has a different criteria, but they also have to work with the cities and the departments of public works, because you can't just dig up a street. So you have to get permission from each town to dig up a street. And so they are constantly working with the utility, with the cities, to say what can we dig up and what can't we. And if it's dangerous, then they have the right to do it. If it's a level three, National Grid told me, I don't know if this is true, but they did say, sometimes we want to fix a street, but they say, those are grade three leaks, we don't have to, we don't want to rip up that street and have everybody be mad at us for ripping up a street.
So is part of your strategy to get the, to somehow change it so that certain level threes of...
yes, oh my goodness, your timing is so perfect. So this study came out in March 2016, so this is almost late breaking news. They looked at 100 Boston area grade three.
I just wanted to know, has there been any conversation with the public health commissioner, Helen?
No, there hasn't. You know, and that's a really good point. That is sort of our... So there are some people who are with... On the pipelines, people are really going after the methane and the toxins associated. And you know, in this state, they don't have to report what's in the gas. You don't have to. There's no reporting requirement, so utility companies do not have to say what chemicals they're putting into the gas, into the methane.
Are you talking about in the pipeline or in the
so the people
refined
who have
gas?
Both. People do not have, other than obviously we know that they have a smelling. But we don't leak, they tell us that they're trade secrets. So one of the things that we're included into the ordinance is that we're saying we would like to know what's in there. We would like to know what are the ingredients. Even if they don't give us the quantities, we want to know what's the stuff that's getting, or that's in it. What are the trace materials that are in it? Yeah.
Well, that's the question about Helen Carlton.
I also want to ask, because I've had conversations with her
yeah.
around how unhealthy Springfield's gas is, I mean, yeah. Springfield's air
yeah.
in general. So I'm just wondering, are you entertaining having...
Can I answer that question? Right now we're trying to get the Public Health Council, which she chairs, to hold a site assignment hearing about whether or not the biomass plant in Indian Orchard should be constructed,
right.
And the developers are threatening to sue the city of Springfield, and I don't know if they're going to make the right decision or not, the Public Health Council, but there is going to be, the next Public Health Council meeting is June 15th, so I would say let us get through this one and then we'll talk to her about gas leaks. We can all talk to her about gas leaks. Let's see what they're going to do on June 15th about the biomass incinerator.
So yeah, you absolutely positively don't want to live
yeah.
next to a compressor station or a power plant or a storage facility, all of those things leaking. You do not want to have those close to your house. And if you do, you should make sure
they
have
fixed them in an orchard.
Yeah, exactly.
Well,
yeah,
but
wait.
One
ballot
at a time.
Yeah.
But you're right.
Our experience is shaming them gets the gas leaks fixed. We focused on the one on our street, which was the one that we knew, and lo and behold, a week later, it was fixed.
That's awesome.
So I think that this thing about they are sensitive
yeah.
to pressure and public. And people drawing them out, people shaming them, I think that we can get far this
yeah.
way.
Yeah.
It occurs to me that we probably have a natural ally in the construction unions, because my guess is that they don't hire enough workers to take care of the leaks that are surfacing. That represents jobs for
right.
union
so
workers.
So interestingly enough, there's a bill right now that's being discussed that is sort of about worker safety. And so we are very aligned with them. Because no question, obviously we want to protect the workers, and they're having to deal with all this stuff, right? Yeah.
Just a suggestion about talking with somebody in power to get landlords involved. I mean, I understand that some renters might be inhibited as far as, you know, there may be a language issue in terms of making a phone call to MassSave and making those arrangements. But it seems to me we have to put the landlord's feet to the fire in terms of mandating that they take some sort of initiative, take some steps to demonstrate that they have insulated their buildings and they've had MassSave come out for an entire building.
So I think that's a great idea. That's the kind of thing that you may want to add to an ordinance. I mean, I think, if there's an ordinance saying that landlords have to make sure that their buildings are insulated, they're going to do it. Right,
Springfield.
Yeah.
Old pass in Springfield.
We now pass in Springfield.
We have a lot of absent landlords. Not only that, but like those that live in public housing have very good connections with the city. So good luck in having the city.
Well, but
go
I think this
after the very, you know, crimes.
You know what though? I really don't underestimate the power of you showing up to your city councilor's office and saying this is what you want. The way we started this in Boston was literally a group of moms and grandmoms trudging to go meet every single city councilor to say, you know, this is not okay. And then suddenly we had the hearing, and I mean, so they care about you. You vote, and if you bring your friends and you bring people who care, they actually, I think, that their public pressure works. I know it doesn't always seem like it, but the more people you have, the more it works.
It just affects the poor the more. So
no question, yeah.
So when you put a lot more pressure on a landlord, who's to say that tenant is gonna like now have to be displaced or whatever? You know, like there's always repercussions on cause and effect on
your landlord. I get it that it's not always great to go to your landlord and they just call you that you're a pain and then they don't do anything. But you can go to your elected official, your city councilor. The thing is, look, think about it this way. If we put together an ordinance that say the landlords have to do this, and then every city councilor is visited by people who vote for them and say, this is important to me, I want to vote on this, they're more likely to pass a bill where they know people who are voting for them care about that bill.
Yeah.
So that's where, really, we have to be informed citizens that meet with our elected officials and say, this is what I want, and I vote, and all my friends vote, and I organize my street to vote. I have my daughter here, she knows I do this. I get everyone on my street to vote on issues.
Good for you.
So folks, Ania has to do the same presentation in Northampton and Little Elsewhere. Are there any last? Thank you so much to Ania and her daughter for coming all the way out from Boston to do this presentation for us. And
can we get these slides?
Yeah. Yeah. So I think we're posting them on our website.
Great.
And so again, thank you all so much for coming out. A special thank you if anybody's here from the Central Massachusetts area or Worcester. We love you. We love you very much.
We love you, man.
We share a lot of common. And so I just want to say, I hope everybody grabbed a flyer on their way in. These are some really important meetings that are coming up, including the Monday meeting for the City Council, where they're going to be doing the resolution on these gas leaks. And they also have a resolution up against the biomass incinerator and against the bill to end the bottle bill. So we have a lot of environmental things on the agenda for City Council on Monday. And we also know that our Springfield City Councilors, a lot of them are environmentally friendly and consider the environment a big part of their platform. We've seen them stand up to the biomass incinerator. So we feel like there's a strong movement on the council already to approve the resolutions and to consider an ordinance. We've already met with two councilors about an ordinance, and so we know that there is room there, but they've got to see people there. So again, thank you all so much for coming out. We're going to stick around a little bit. Another round of applause for Ania and enjoy.
For that, but we're trying to figure out what are ways that we could do it. So anyway, so this is really exciting. The other thing that's really important that's not on here, but since you're such an educated, smart job, 15% of these were misclassified. They were grade 3s and they were actually grade 1. Yeah.
15?
Wow. Yeah. Ooh. Yeah. So, and I'm going to take that back. They're either grade 1 or grade 2. But that is in the study, and that is something that people aren't focusing. They are mislabeling some of these leaks, or
the other thing that could happen is that over time,
they change from a 2 to 1.
But that's the reason why that's important is because that means that we can't just ignore grade 3 leaks. Mm-hmm. We have to be really
monitored.
Yeah.
Is the grade 3 is near a residence?
That's a grade 2 is within 5 feet of the foundation of a building.
And so grade 3 is more than 5 feet from any building.
Yep.
Okay.
And it's has very zero practically likelihood of explosion.
And sometimes those methane leaks are huge. Absolutely.
A California leak was a grade 3 leak. Uh-huh. So that was, six fire coal plants today.
We had an explosion in the center of Greenfield, but nobody would tell us where it was.
Oh, really?
Nobody was hurt.
Oh, good.
It was fine. But it rocked. I live a long way away from it, and it rocked the glasses in the cabinets.
Mm-hmm. Do you know, is it true that the grade 3 leaks don't explode?
Yes, I think it's by, well, obviously not, because they were saying that they're grade 3. There's like 15 of them are actually not grade 3, they're exploding. But the way it's been defined, so the way for things to explode, they have to be in a contained space for it to explode. It's a certain percent of methane in a contained space is what makes it blow. And it's actually even, like, it can't be that it's super high concentration and not super low. It's like, there's like a certain amount concentration in a contained space that makes it blow. So if it's out in the field, it will never blow.
Okay.
So, Nia, I would just want to suggest that we let Nia get to the end.
Yes.
We're getting close to when we want to end. And then we can stay here
talk,
longer
right?
as long as you
want. Yeah, look at this. We're at the very exciting part, what we're doing about it. This is the fun part where you've heard a lot about the fun things we're doing, but Mothers Out Front, so as I mentioned, a year and a half ago, we started in a little living room, just a few of us reading the Boston Globe. And so now we have 12 teams across the state working on this, including Andrew's team in Pioneer Valley is taking on leaks. And when I say teams, so they have gone out and tagged the leaks, done cork, they have done across the board really great stuff and gotten a lot of media attention for leaks, which has been really fun. And then here, sort of to think about Mothers Out Front, big picture, our goal for 3 years, so 2016 to 2018, is to pressure the electric utility companies to stop supporting new gas pipelines and instead support more energy efficiency and renewable energy.
Yeah.
That is our goal, and we are not, I mean, yes, we do stuff in the legislature, yes, but we are going after the utilities and the DPU to pressure them to start caring about climate. So we are trying to change the narrative of natural gas, and I hope everybody here today is going to think about those fracking fields when you think natural, when you have that advertising of the clean bus, or when you hear on NPR that Colorado Airport is, based with clean natural gas, that it's not true.
Thinkaboutit.org.
Think about it.
Exactly, that's our campaign. That's now you know. We're trying to fix the leaks. We're trying to fight the pipelines. Nice job on you all fighting the pipelines.
Yay!
And we're supporting renewable energy. So this is our campaign. All of the Mothers Out Front teams are doing this. Super exciting. And very importantly, Mothers Out Front could never ever do this without the help of other people. I mentioned a lot of these, but Professor Nathan Phillip has been incredible working with us. Bob Ackley is the one who measures everything. Sierra Club Heat does the maps. CLF does the lawsuits, which is why we have the Global Warming Solution Act. Clean Water Action is incredible. Many of you know Joel Wool. He's unbelievable. And Boston Climate Action Network also working really closely with us. This is a team that has been working together. We meet every 2 weeks. And we do all of this in conjunction. Many of these slides we share, we really have been, it's been a team effort. Then we had a bunch of people who care about trees join our group. The Green Space Alliance, the Friends, the Emerald Necklace, which has been really great because they are looking at it from a different perspective. And now the most exciting thing, we have you all. I'm in action now, and Two Big Beans and the Springfield Climate Justice and Arise Springfield. And it's so awesome that you all are taking this on and that you're interested in this. And we are super excited to work with you because I think if we all take this on together, we can really actually make something happen. So wait, there's more. So here's on the leaks. This is a really cute kid. I wish the gas leaks would go away, but unfortunately, just wishing them away doesn't work. So we are, one of the things that we are doing is that we have 35 cities and towns across Massachusetts passed two really important bills. I mean, they're passed resolutions to support two really important bills. House Bill 2870 says that you should not be charging us for the lost gas. The utility company should be paying for the lost gas. So that $90 million, we, the ratepayer, we don't want it included in our rates. That's that bill. And just so that you know, this bill passed in Texas and Pennsylvania, two giant fracking states. And then the other one is the road repair bill. And this says that anytime you open up a road, the gas leak companies, the utilities, have to come and fix the leaks. Even if they're grade three, you have to fix the leaks every time a road is open.
Okay.
So where these are right now, this one, they both made it to the Energy Committee. This one went out to study, which I guess means that it goes out to pasture.
Yes.
This one is in the Senate Ways and Means Committee, and we're trying to get that passed. We've added some amendments. The key amendment that we're adding here is the idea of the 7% volume. So we're saying fix the top 10% leaks in the first year, which kind of does the same thing as this. So we're trying to fit the intent of this into this bill. That's the process that we're doing there. Now, if it should not pass the State House, what we are doing, and I know you all are doing with Marty's been leading the way, is that we have written an ordinance that we're trying to pass in Boston that does a lot of the same stuff in these bills. So if it doesn't pass at the State House, at least at the Boston level, we're gonna try and get things that if the roads are open, you gotta fix them. If the 10%, fix the 10% grade leak. We've added tree stuff, we've added all sorts of things. We're hoping it all passes. I'm sure they'll get chopped up. But I've given that resolution to Marty, so it would be great. Yeah, it would be great if you all could pass that here too. And then this I've talked about a lot, which is that we're reaching out to the utility companies to fix the biggest leaks. We're trying to go at it at all the angles, right? So Conservation Law Foundation is going the lawsuit angle, which they do so well. We within Mothers Out Front are working with our allies to do these three things, and would love it for you all to be involved doing these three things, and you are. I mean, I think here is a really fun map of all the cities and towns that have passed resolutions. Here's the really fun thing. This Boston one where we started, it started, we passed it September, I think end of September 2015. So it's not even been a year, and all of this has happened, which is super exciting. And here's the super exciting thing for you all. You notice how this is all empty? Northampton has done. So you are ahead of the game, but if you are not from Northampton, you can maybe help us pass resolutions of support, because they help us get these bills passed to the Senate, through the Ways and Means Committee. If we can say, right now it's a little over 30% of the population, the more cities and towns that pass these resolutions, the more we can say we have support from across the state. And representing a huge number of the population.
Where can we get a copy of the map?
Oh my gosh, I can send it to you. I did this, I think, yesterday, so you can have it. Yeah, I can send it to you, yeah. And you know what, the thing is that we update it all the time. Springfield, I'm hoping, is gonna pass on Monday, which would be so exciting, because they are a big
population. So just town meeting will pass these? That's what they get passed?
Yeah.
Or city council.
City council, that's right. Yeah, and you know, it's actually not a hard pass, because they don't have to do anything. They just have to support, you know, what the state is doing. The ordinance is the hard part, because then they actually have to be accountable for doing that. So what can you all do? So you all are having a the world we love. So I think Andrea is going to try and on July 2nd, she has a little hand up. They're going to try to tag all the leaks, which is really exciting. We are asking you all to attend a city council hearing, date to be determined, on an ordinance that Marty is working on.
Not me, but Peggy. Peggy, do you want to tell what Ryan O'Donnell, you want to read Ryan's thing? This is from Ryan O'Donnell, who is writing the ordinance for us. that will be presented TBD.
Okay.
Awesome.
So this is a statement from Ryan. Thank you for your activism on an issue of great importance to the environment, to the economy, to public safety, and to the public interest. Repairing natural gas leaks in the distribution system within Northampton and across the Commonwealth is certainly an appropriate topic to discuss at the local level, where the effects of aging and sometimes ignored infrastructure is often felt firsthand. And I'm grateful you are calling attention to the issue now. Government at all levels must remember that they are accountable to the people when setting policy, and the for-profit interests of corporations should never override that principle. I think that this is certainly true in this case. I hope you will continue to educate the City Council and other officials regarding best practices and possible remedies and ideas being explored by other communities, so that whatever policies or actions are ultimately considered in our city are guided by the most information and greatest insight possible. I believe you have a city government willing to listen and understand this issue better, and I also believe the principles animating your work, among them corporate accountability and the ambitious but necessary goal of transitioning fully to a clean energy future, are completely in line with the beliefs of our community. I look forward to more discussion and hearing more from you soon. And as always, do not hesitate to contact me.
Anyway, he is dedicated to fashioning an ordinance based on the Boston ordinance.
All right, we have a little bit more. Here's the number if you want to put it into your phone. Columbia Gas Emergency Line. Every time you smell a leak, call Columbia Gas. That's their number, 1-800-525-8. This is I found on the internet. Hope it's right. Call with a gas leak from Boston. 8222. And then community leaders will be meeting with Columbia Gas, and I think the emphasis will be hopefully addressing the biggest leaks. What's the process? I think sort of saying to them, you have all these missing leaks, is probably blaming versus trying to get them fixed the darn
gushers.
If you are not from Northampton, we would love to have more red dots up on that map. So it would be great. All you have to do is meet with your city councilor. This is honest to goodness how it works. You meet with your city councilor, you tell them what's going on, you give them a map of your town with the dots, and you say, look, it's so easy, let's pass these resolutions. And then they do.
Can I just get a couple of people to just shout out? Like, where are you?
And is there somebody not with him?
Yes, yeah, where you are, you know.
Pelham.
Greenfield.
Amherst.
Northampton.
Yay!
He's not Amherst.
East Amherst.
No. Amherst. Get together, everyone.
That's so great. So, you know, one of the things is that we have this little presentation that that's really easy. You get the map from Heat. So that really important when you sit with your city councilor, to show them the map of your town and say, this is the map, look at all these leaks. And then you go through the presentation, and then you ask them to support it. And it's actually been really effective in 35 towns, so we ask you all to do that.
There's also a statewide listserv for gas leaks for folks who are in the other towns. That's not real high flow, but for Greenfield, Amherst, and Pelham and those places, maybe somebody from each of those places could get on the listserv.
That would be really great. Yeah.
Are your slides available online somewhere?
So it's so interesting. I change my slides for every meeting. They're always up to date, and I try to tailor it to you. So here's the deal. I can send these slides to Marty, and you can use them. But just know that it's constantly changing. So that's part of the issue. But I'm a little reticent, just because, honest to goodness, I change it every week.
Right.
Because there's new information every week.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
How long do we have to wait to get you booked into Greenfield?
How far is Greenfield?
Tonight.
Let's see, 9 o'clock. We could do one from now. well, I'll give you my email and we can chat. And see if there's. It's very beautiful out here, so I might consider coming back.
And you'll be closer to Greenfield if you come on Route 2.
Yeah.
I mean, there's no further.
Right.
To get to Greenfield isn't further than Northampton. You just come a different way.
Yeah.
So
okay.
I just before when people start needing to go. The thing I passed out, some people got the pretty colorful one, has a series of meetings and events that are related to pipelines, a bunch of them related to the gas leaks. And if you want to join in this effort to, you know, focused at first on Northampton, but you know, we got a bunch of people in Amherst, we're gonna be, you know, doing what we can there. Make sure that your name is on the list. If you, I know Lisa sent the Mothers Out Front list around, right? Was going around. We'll treat that as the same, that you wanna be on the list of people connected to this gas leaks effort. But I also have one here that has, you know, you can check if you're not on the CAN mailing list yet, you can check that off. If you didn't sign the on the Mothers Out Front one and you want to be on our list, check that off too. So so we can stay in touch and, you know,
Our Green Neighbors group is meeting a week from tonight at my house. So please come and we'll figure out
it's
about
here.
And who
marking.
Are you?
I'm Christine Olson. I live near the high school.
So 6-9, that's the first event.
Shows my address. So.
And that will be a place where, you know, we can have reporting in about, you know, when the meeting is going to be with Columbia Gas president and whatever, you know, it is happening at the city council level. And so, and yeah, other and ideas I, and how to get.
I've also brought you a lot of them.
Yeah.
We'll find you the flash.
Oh, great. I'd just like to make one other announcement of something that you could do if you wanted to, which is the Attorney General, who has one of her titles is ratepayer advocate.
Yeah.
And she's been doing a pretty good job of trying to be that for us.
She's fabulous.
And she has asked members of her staff to go out around the state and have listening sessions. And there's a listening session in Springfield at the UMass Center, that tower, whatever. Tower Center, UMass.
Yeah.
Springfield. On
June 16th,
but I can't remember what time. I think it's 6 o'clock.
Well, I've got it on my phone.
If you all sign up for the Climate Action Now newsletter,
it'll be in the Climate Action Now newsletter. And it's if some of you had gone to like the other types of hearings, like DPU and FERC, it's very different from that. It's a little more low key, and it's more like a conversation. They talk back to us. It's not just it's not just a hearing where you speak and you feel like you aren't heard, but they respond.
And they also she did something really amazing, which is that before we had like an environment group and an energy group, she joined the environment energy, and they really are taking this really seriously. So they are fabulous people to talk to.
And there's a card going around. It's a little white card. If you see it on the back, there's a way. If you want to just be active every week, you can do something called Monday Actions. It's like a baking mix for how to write to your or call your representatives. So it just cycles through representatives, president, very to the local. We even had one for Maura Healy on the pipeline in Otis. So if you wanted to sort of have that at your beck and call. That's on the back of this card, tells you how to get those.
Where's the cards? Where are you going to hold
them? Wait, so Izzy, I'll give
that to Susan.
Hi, Izzy.
Izzy.
Yeah.
Hello.
We love Izzy.
I'm on staff at Mothers Out Front. I'm the Massachusetts community organizer. I grew up here. I live in Athol now. For all of you non-Amherst folks, if you are interested in Mothers Out Front, please let me know. If you are in Amherst,
Amherst, but then
Amherst has a team already. We're looking to start other teams in Western Massachusetts. I am the person to talk to, or if you just have questions about Mothers Out Front, let me know.
Yeah. And just so that you all know, I would like you all to join all of these organizations because it's so awesome. Climate Action Now and Get Their Action Alerts, of course, Mothers Out Front. Join 2 Degrees and the Unitarian Climate Action. Because you know what? Here's the thing. I promise you that it's together that we can do this. I join everything because I feel like we are like one giant family that's trying to protect this earth. So yeah.
Well, there is one other really important thing.
Yeah.
You happen to be in the home territory for Senate President Stan Rosenberg, who has quite a bit of influence.
Amherst.
Greenfield.
Oh,
yeah.
Greenfield.
Just
Springfield.
No,
he lives in all of us.
Right now.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
That is so important.
It is very important.
Yeah.
And so every person in here should be writing Stan Rosenberg about that bill.
Yeah.
You better put the bill number back up.
It's currently Ways and Means. It's in the Senate. And it is 1767.
We'll put it in a Monday action, so make sure it makes sense.
1767, that is a fabulous fact. So that is so important. Our elected officials, as you know, respond to what you all say. They really care about their voters. Honest to goodness, I've been so amazed by how effective it is to reach out to our elected officials. We have made huge differences doing that.
Yeah. Do you have a group in Framingham?
We do not.
Not yet.
Whoa.
Talk to me.
Izzy is your woman. I will go and chat. But you know, also the other thing is anybody who wants to learn to do this, I mean, like, you can also. So here's the thing. A year and a half ago, I was in a living room and I learned about gas leaks. And I have learned all of that last year and a half, right? So this is not my background.
You're right.
It is, you all can do it. We are all can be informed people. You don't have to be an expert. Like, if you don't know, you just say, I don't know. I'll look it up. I'll let you know. But it is really, you all can go and talk about this. And I think there's so many experts that can help us.
Yeah. Lynn.
Oh, I just, to piggyback on what you said, Pam, about Senator Rosenberg, he will sometimes take a long time to get to a position you want him to get to because he has so much influence and he has to really walk a fine line because he's president of the Senate. But I called and left him a voicemail one day and said, you know, you wrote a piece in the paper and you're not coming down on the right side on this thing, and I want you to actually tell us exactly where you stand. And this was early days in the pipeline stuff. I left him a message, I left him my phone number, and my phone rang 5 minutes later and it was him calling me back. And he was upset that I had the impression that he wasn't against the pipeline. I said, well, the piece in the paper, you don't come down firm enough to say you're against it. I want you to be more clear. And so I'm just saying, it works.
Yeah.
I was so surprised when my cell phone rang and it was Stan Rosenberg.
It works because we are his constituents.
Yeah.
I mean, it doesn't work for you to call somebody halfway across the state.
We need people in the Leos.
One really, really important thing for this legislative session is that new energy bill that came out does not say anything about the tax. And the DPU did pass that tax. And so they can really charge us for those pipelines. And so I think it's really important, either for the legislation to write a bill that forbids it, that's included in the energy bill. So that's another thing that's really important to get across to your elected officials, and the DPU, right? The DPU approved the tax. The other person, I mean, fortunately, Maura Healy is on our side on this. I don't think she thinks that the tax is necessary, so hopefully she will be working on that. But the two places are the DPU and the state legislature. I mean, we cannot have a tax.
I met with Stan Rosenberg, and this is one thing we talked about, and he said that he doesn't think it's legal, that the legislature thinks that it's not legal for the DPU to make that decision. So that's one reason why it's not likely that they'll make legislation forbidding it, since they don't think it's permissible.
Well, if they don't, then they should make it clear.
Right.
So right now we can be taxed.
I want us to be able to wrap up here, even though there's so much more to talk about. Come next week. Do look at this. July 2nd is our launch date that we're going to really just cover the entire city in Northampton with signs or flags. We're going to figure that out next week.